السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
الله أكبر الله أكبر. الله أكبر الله أكبر. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله. أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله. أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله. حي على الصلاة. حي على الصلاة. الفلاح. حي على الفلاح.
من يهده الله تعالى فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن سيدنا محمدا صلى الله عليه وسلم عبده ورسوله وخفيه وخليله، بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح الأمة وجاهد في سبيل الله حق جهاده حتى أتاه اليقين. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين وصحابته الصالحين الغر الميامين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدي سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. ثم أما بعد، brothers and sisters, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, addressing us as a nation of believers, كنتم خير أمة أخرجت للناس تأمرون بالمعروف وتنهون عن المنكر وتؤمنون بالله. He says, you are the best community evolved for mankind, the best ummah that has ever been evolved for mankind. And then he tells us what makes us special and unique and the best. He says there are three things. تأمرون بالمعروف وتنهون عن المنكر وتؤمنون بالله. You are the best community evolved for mankind because you enjoin what is right and you forbid what is wrong and you believe in Allah. You enjoin what is right. In other words, you command that which is good, that which is right. You advise people to do that which is just and fair and good. You instruct them to do that. You remind them to do that. You demand that people act in ways that are right, that are moral, that are just and fair. And وَتَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ, and you forbid what is wrong. You condemn what is unjust and unfair. You discourage people from doing things that are immoral, that are wrong. وَتُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ, and you believe in Allah. Brothers and sisters, الْأَمْرُ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَالنَّهْيُ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ, loosely translated as commanding what is right and forbidding what is wrong, is a duty that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala placed upon the shoulders of the prophets. But after Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there will be no prophet. And therefore this duty was passed down to those who believe in Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was very clear in communicating this responsibility to us, every single one of us, when he said, مَنْ رَأَى مِنْكُمْ مُنْكَرًا فَلْيُغَيِّرْهُ بِيَدِهِ فَإِنْ لَمْ يَسْتَطِعْ فَبِلِسَانِهِ فَإِنْ لَمْ يَسْتَطِعْ فَبِقَلْبِهِ وَذَلِكَ أَضْعَفُ الْإِيمَانِ. He said, whoever amongst you sees a munkar, sees something that is wrong, that is unjust, that is evil, that is harmful, that is immoral, a munkar, whoever from amongst you sees a munkar, they must change it with their hands, physically stopping that munkar. Whoever amongst you, not just the government, not just the police, not just the shura members, not just the committee members, not just the security, not just the imam or the sheikh or the scholar, whoever amongst you, man ra'a minkum munkaran, falyughayyirhu, they must, it is an obligation, lamuna lamul amr, as the Arabs know, falyughayyirhu biyadih, they must, it is a command from God, an obligation upon us to stop that. Not just to turn the other way, that's none of my business. When we see an injustice, a wrong happening, it is our responsibility to stand up for justice against the injustices. Otherwise, we have failed to fulfill the obligation placed upon us. They must change it, avert it, stop it, correct it with their hands, physically. فَإِنْ لَمْ يَسْتَطِعْ, but if you are not able to do that, فَبِلِسَانِهِ, then you must change it with your tongue. Speak out against it. فَإِنْ لَمْ يَسْتَطِعْ, and if you're not even able to do that, despite living in a free country, فَبِقَلْبِهِ وَذَلِكَ أَضْعَفُ الْإِيمَانِ, then you must hate it inside of your heart, and that is the weakest form of faith. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, وَالَّذِي نَفْسِي بِيَدِهِ لَتَأْمُرُنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَلَتَنْهَوُنَّ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ أَوْ لَيُوشِكَنَّ اللَّهُ أَنْ يَبْعَثَ عَلَيْكُمْ عِقَابًا مِنْهُ ثُمَّ تَدْعُونَهُ فَلَا يُسْتَجَابُ لَكُمْ. He said, I swear by the one in whose hands is my soul, either you will do الْأَمْرُ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَالنَّهْيُ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ, either you will command what is right and forbid what is wrong, or Allah will send down upon you a punishment from Him, after which you will implore Him in dua for relief, but He will not respond to your dua. This is how serious it is, brothers and sisters. And it is not just the responsibility of those quote unquote in authority. As he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, كلكم راعٍ, Every single one of you is an authority. Every single one of you is a shepherd. وَكُلُّكُمْ مَسْئُولٌ عَنْ رَعِيَتِهِ And you will be asked about your flock. وَالرَّجُلُ رَاعٍ فِي أَهْلِ بَيْتِهِ مَسْئُولٌ عَنْ رَعِيَتِهِ The man, every man, is a shepherd over the members of his family. مَسْئُولٌ عَنْ رَعِيَتِهِ And he will be questioned about his flock. والمرأة راعية في بيت زوجها ومسؤولة عن رعيتها And the woman, every woman, is a shepherd over the home of her husband and she will be questioned about her flock. كلكم راعٍ Every single one of us has a responsibility over the people that we have influenced. Whether it's at work, or at home, or in the masjid, or in the nation, or on the globe. Every single one of us has a circle of influence, and we are going to be questioned about that circle. And yes, this includes our family at home. And that's where it begins, actually. As Rasulullah, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا طُوْ أَنفُسَكُمْ وَأَهْلِيكُمْ نَارًا وَقُودُهَا النَّاسُ وَالْحِجَارَةُ O you who believe, protect yourselves and your family members from a fire whose fuel is human beings and rocks. It is our responsibility, every single one of us, to do al-amru bil-ma'roof wal-nahyu 'anil munkar to our family members, to correct their mistakes when they make mistakes, to encourage them to do what is good and moral, to create an environment that facilitates for them to live a moral life. It is our duty as parents not just to be the breadwinner, and put food on the table, and toys in the toy room, and bicycles in the garage, but to shield our children from the fire of hell. How do we do that? By creating an atmosphere that facilitates for them to live a moral life. That's our responsibility. And yes, that includes correcting mistakes when there are mistakes being made. But brothers and sisters, today's khutbah is not really about that. Today's khutbah is about something else related to that. Which is, despite the fact that this is such an important obligation in our being, to give advice, to correct mistakes, to command what is right and forbid what is wrong, it is also very important that we learn the proper guidelines to carry out this responsibility. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has told us that we must fulfill this responsibility according to certain guidelines. And if we don't, then we would be the ones doing the munkar. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, أُدْعُوا إِلَى سَبِيلِ رَبِّكَ بِالْحِكْمَةِ وَالْمَوْعِظَةِ الْحَسَنَةِ وَجَادِلْهُمْ بِالَّتِي هِيَ أَحْسَنُ إِلَى آخِرِ الْآيَاتِ As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أُدْعُوا Invite to the path of your Lord with wisdom and beautiful preaching and debate and argue and dialogue with people in ways that are most beautiful. This ayah of the Qur'an encapsulates the guidelines that we must follow whenever we correct a mistake in our family, or in the masjid, or at the national or international level. The proper guidelines for giving advice, for commanding what is good and forbidding what is wrong. Ud'u, invite. Invite, it's an invitation, da'wah. Da'wat is a da'wat, is an invitation. How do you invite someone? With harshness? With a loud voice and a stick in your hand? How do you give an invitation to someone? Udru, invite. To what? Not to your path, not to your rules, not to your principles, not to your ego. إِلَى سَبِيلِ رَبِّكَ, to the path of your Lord. بِالْحِكْمَةِ, with wisdom. وَالْمَوْعِظَةِ الْحَسَنَةِ, and with beautiful preaching. How do I correct the mistakes of my wife? Why do I correct the mistakes of my wife? Who is it that I'm calling her to? How do I correct the mistakes of my children? And why do I correct the mistakes of my children? And what is the end goal behind all that? This ayah encapsulates for us the guidelines that we must follow when correcting mistakes and giving advice. In the few minutes that I have left, I would like to break this down further and give some practical guidelines for correcting mistakes, for giving advice, for commanding good and forbidding evil. I have 10 points here. I don't believe I will get to all of them, but whatever the time allows for, inshallah ta'ala. Number one, brothers and sisters, these are necessary guidelines for commanding good and forbidding evil. And if we don't follow these guidelines, then we would be the ones doing the munkar. We are the ones then that need to be corrected. Number one, al-ikhlas, sincerity. Yes, brothers and sisters, when we advise someone, what is my motivation for advising them? What is it that is driving me to give that advice or make that correction? What is the motivation? What is the drive? The drive has to be the right drive. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was preaching his people, was inviting them to Islam because he was genuinely concerned for them. It wasn't about for his own personal ego that they have to follow me because of who I am. I set the rules. Now everybody must follow because I am the head. No. Out of genuine concern for the well-being of his people. فَلَعَلَّكَ بَاطِعُ النَّفْسَةَ عَلَىٰ آثَارِهِمْ إِن لَّمْ يُؤْمِنُوا بِهَذَا الْحَدِيثِ أَسْرَفًا. As Allah says in Surah Al-Kahf, are you going to kill yourself? Are you going to destroy yourself out of sadness and concern because your people are refusing to follow your message? That's the concern that a da'i has to the one that he is doing da'wah to. That has to be the drive. That has to be the motivation. إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَاتِ وَإِنَّمَا لِكُلِّ امْرِئٍ مَّا نَوَى. As Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, that every action is judged according to the intention. What is my intention for giving advice? What is my intention for correcting the mistake? Is it to feed my own ego, to establish my authority? Is it to put the other person down? What is the motivation? What is the drive? Ikhlas, sincerity, is very important, brothers and sisters. I don't yell and scream at my children when they make a mistake to establish my authority over them. I discipline them if there's a need to discipline them because I want to refine their character. Because I want them to grow up to be beautiful human beings in the way that they conduct themselves with other people and with their Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala. That has to be the motivation. That has to be the drive. Al-ikhlas. Number two, al-ilm, knowledge. Knowledge is essential, brothers and sisters, especially when it comes to commanding good and forbidding evil. Because when I am forbidding an evil, I have to know, is this really an evil or not? I'm getting all riled up about something. Is it really something that is wrong? Or maybe this is something on which there is a difference of opinion among the ulama. I can't go and tell somebody in the masjid, brother, you can't do this. You cannot pray like this. This is wrong. When there is a legitimate difference of opinion about it among the four schools of thought, I cannot do that. If I do that, then I am the one who is doing munkar. I have to know, is this something on which there is agreement? Or is this something on which there is a legitimate disagreement? There is room, there's some flexibility here. So I have to have knowledge of that which I'm trying to correct. Al-ilm. Number three, ar-rifqu wal-leen, gentleness. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, bil-hikmati wal-maw'idati al-hasana, call to the way of your Lord with wisdom and with beautiful preaching. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told Sayyidina Musa and Sayyidina Harun alayhim as-salam that they must go and do al-amru bil-ma'roof wal-nahyu anil-munkar to Fir'aun, they must go and give advice to Fir'aun and point out the injustices that he is committing. Go and speak to that tyrant. He told them, وَقُولَا لَهُ قَوْلًا لَيِّنًا. Speak to him in a way that is soft, in a way that is gentle. If that is how Musa and Harun were instructed to speak to Fir'aun, the greatest tyrant that this world has ever seen, then what about when we correct the mistakes of our own family members, or our colleagues or co-workers, our team members over whom we may be in charge, or our brothers and sisters in the masjid who say La ilaha illallah? Gentleness, brothers and sisters. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to his wife, our mother, Sayyida Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, Inna Allah rafiq yuhibbu al-rizq wa yu'ti ala al-rizq ma la yu'ti ala al-unf وَمَا لَا يُعْطِي عَلَى مَا سِوَاهُ. And he said to her, إِنَّ الرِّزْقَ لَا يَكُونُ فِي شَيْءٍ إِلَّا زَانَهُ وَلَا يُنْزَعُ مِنْ شَيْءٍ إِلَّا شَانَهُ. He said to her, and there's a story behind it which we don't have time to go into. He said to her, Ya Aisha, indeed Allah is gentle and He loves gentleness. إِنَّ اللَّهَ رَفِيقٌ يُحِبُّ الرِّفْقِ. Allah is gentle and He has hub for gentleness. وَيُعْطِي عَلَى الرِّفْقِ مَا لَا يُعْطِي عَلَى الْعُنْفِ. And He grants on account of gentleness what He will not grant on account of harshness. Sometimes we use harshness, but at the end we don't get the result what we want, and we become harsher and harsher and harsher. And what we don't realize is that Allah is not going to give that to us because of our own wrong attitude. He gives on account of gentleness what He will not give on account of harshness, and what He will not give on account of anything other than gentleness. And He said, indeed, whenever gentleness is introduced in anything, it only beautifies it. And whenever it is removed from anything, it only leaves it ugly. So that's the third guideline, brothers and sisters, for giving advice, for correcting mistakes, for doing al-amru bil-ma'roof wal-nahyu 'anil munkar. Number four, al-qudwatul hasana, setting a beautiful example by my own actions. If I'm trying to invite people to the way of Allah, if I'm trying to influence people to become moral and good, if I'm trying to change the behavior of someone from bad to good, I have to exhibit good behavior in my own self. You see, brothers and sisters, Luqman alayhi salam, al-Hakim, Luqman the wise, whose story Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Quran, the advice that he gave to his son as he was dying on his deathbed. Among what he said to him was what? He said to him, Ya Bunayya, أقم الصلاة وأمر بالمعروف وانهى عن المنكر واصبر على ما أصابك. He said to him, My son, establish prayer, enjoin what is right, forbid what is wrong, and be patient with that which afflicts you. This tartib, this sequence of advice is deliberate and is wise. The first thing he tells him is aqimis salah, establish prayer. In other words, fix your own self. Fix your relationship with Allah. Fix your conduct and akhlaq. Aqimis salah, fix yourself. وَأْمُرْ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ And after that he mentions, enjoin what is right to others, and forbid what is wrong to others. وَصْبِرْ عَلَى مَا أَصَابَكَ And be patient with that which befalls you. Brothers and sisters, we sometimes, you know, actions speak louder than words. We know that. Actions speak louder than words. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, He transformed people from kufr to Islam, from shirk to al-wahdaniya, simply by being who he was. Oftentimes he didn't even have to say anything. And when he did say things, people would put their fingers in their ears. But when they saw his conduct, أَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَّهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَأَنَّكَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ How many times do we see that in the seerah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? When people are put in situations where they don't have a choice but to observe this human being, this messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they can't help but see the beauty of his teachings through his own actions. Brothers and sisters, if we deal with people around us in the prophetic way, sometimes we don't even have to say anything. We don't have to order. We don't have to command. People will naturally feel connected to Islam, to the Quran, to Allah Azza wa Jal, to the masjid, because they will realize that my beautiful conduct stems from my relationship with Allah and with the Quran and with the masjid. And they will want to have that connection that I have. Instead of getting all upset with my daughter because she's not wearing hijab, instead of treating her with harshness and with bad language because she's not listening to me and wearing the scarf, if I can attract her to Islam, to Allah, to the Quran, because of my own kind and gentle and beautiful behavior with her, that, brothers and sisters, will go a long way than me telling her to do something right, but in my own behavior I am far from what is right. Because of the way that I speak to her, because of the way that I behave at home, I have to set the example, al-qudwatul hasana. I have to be a role model to others if I want their behavior to be corrected, if I want them to take that path which is right and beautiful and moral. And number five, brothers and sisters, is al-sabr, patience and perseverance. When I do al-amru bil-ma'ruf wal-nahyu al-munkar, when I invite others to the path of Allah, when I correct people's mistakes, when I give advice to others, Sometimes it takes time. I can't give up. I have to be persistent. And I have to be patient. And in that same ayah, Surat Luqman, if you notice, after he told him, أَقِمِ الصَّلَاةِ and then to do الْأَمْرُ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَالنَّهِي عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ, the next thing he says is, اصبر على ما أصابك. Be patient with that which afflicts you. As if he is telling his son that the two come hand in hand. If you're going to advise people, if you're going to correct people's mistakes, then be prepared of facing challenges, of facing difficulties. Be prepared. You will face affliction, and therefore be patient. وَاصْبِرْ عَلَى مَا أَصَابَكْ. Be patient. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Qur'an, in the surah that all of us know. وَالْعَصْرِ إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي قُسْرِ إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالْحَقِّ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالصَّبْرِ. Indeed, mankind is in loss except for those who believe and do righteous deeds and those who encourage one another with the truth, i.e. doing al-amru bil-ma'ruf wa nahi al-munkar, encouraging good and forbidding bad, وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالصَّبْرِ, and those who encourage one another to be patient. You see, patience is coupled with encouraging, advising, correcting one another. If I don't observe patience in the way that I give advice, in the way that I correct mistakes, then I am the one who needs to be corrected. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم فاستغفروه فيا فوز المستغفرين. الحمد لله رب العالمين وأفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. ثم أما بعد. Brothers and sisters, we're talking about important guidelines that we have to observe as we command what is good and forbid what is evil, as we advise people, as we correct people's mistakes, whether it's in the family at home or at work or in the masjid or in the nation at the national level, at the international level. I talked about 5 guidelines. I have 10 here. I'm not going to get to all of them. So let me just mention one more, insha'Allah ta'ala. The 6th one, brothers and sisters, is التدرج ومراعاة الأولويات, which basically means gradualism and prioritization. And this is also encapsulated in that ayah that we began with. ادعو إلى سبيل ربك بالحكمة. Call to the way of your Lord with wisdom. And part of wisdom is gradualism and prioritization. What do I mean by that? Brothers and sisters, there are things that are more important than others. Not everything is at the same level. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the Quran over the course of 23 years. There were things that he didn't even talk about for the first 13 years in Mecca. In Mecca, the emphasis was on Iman and on Akhlaq, on Tawheed and Akhlaq. That was the emphasis in the first 13 years of prophethood. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not even tell the Muslims that they have to fast. He did not even give them the obligation of the 5 daily salawat for the first 10 or 11 or 12 years. the rules of inheritance, even khamr, intoxicants, alcohol. Companions used to drink it. Even after 15, 16 years of the Quran being revealed. It wasn't until later in Medina, after the Battle of Uhud, that khamr was forbidden, which is a major sin now, to drink alcohol. Why? Because there are other things that are more important than that, that needed attention first, and that could wait, even if it needed to wait for more than 10 years. But brothers and sisters, do we prioritize when we're trying to develop a prophetic household or a prophetic community? Do we prioritize? There are things that need to happen gradually, and we need to prioritize and giving more importance to things that are more important. Iman and akhlaq were more important to Allah Azza wa Jal than even putting a hijab on the head of the believing women. Because hijab was not made obligatory until the Prophet ﷺ married Zainab bint Jahsh, which was later in Medina. Until then, there was no commandment for hijab. So we have to also prioritize things properly. That is part of the important guidelines that we have to follow when we are trying to give advice, correct mistakes, enjoin what is right, and forbid what is wrong. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us among those who listen to the words of admonition and follow the best of them. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us for our mistakes. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept from us our good deeds. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us agents of good and agents of justice wherever we go. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us among those who enjoin what is right and forbid what is wrong in a way that is pleasing to Him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala ali Sayyidina Muhammad kama sallaita ala Sayyidina Ibrahim wa ala ali Sayyidina Ibrahim wa barik ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala ali Sayyidina Muhammad kama barakta ala Sayyidina Ibrahim wa ala ali Sayyidina Ibrahim fil alameen innaka hamidu majid. Allahumma aghfir lil mu'minin wal mu'minat wal muslimin wal muslimat الأحياء منهم والأموات إنك يا مولانا سميع قريب مجيب الدعوات برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم اشف مرضانا واشف مرضى المسلمين وارحم موتانا وارحم موتى المسلمين وفرج عن عبادك المستضعفين المظلومين في مشارق الأرض ومغاربها عادلا غير آجل يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم الطف بالبلاد والعباد يا لطيف يا أرحم الراحمين. قوموا إلى صلاتكم يرحمكم الله.
الله أكبر الله أكبر. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله. حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح قد قامت الصلاة قد قامت الصلاة. الله أكبر.